Namaste and welcome to this exciting new episode of Satology Debunking Mythology. Sat means truth, logos means a study or science. Satology means a science of truth or study of truth. Opposite of that is mythology, which means a science of fake lie imagination or study of fake lie imagination. Mythology destroys your identity while satology builds your identity. You need to know that. Because unless you come in touch with your ancestral history, your identity is not made. And believe me, everyone is searching for identity. That's why in religious studies, creation is a very important topic. And if the creation is not described, look at any culture of the world. There are 3,000 Native American cultures in North America only. People did not know that. Every one of them follows a common story of creation. The most authentic story of creation comes from Vedic literatures with names, persons, and the process of creation. And you will find Brahma, how he is engaged in creating this world, and before Brahma is Vishnu. And then, so all these aspects are covered in all the major native traditions. Native means original traditions of the land. The imposition destroys those traditions, and that's why we are not for it. I have a very, very special guest, a researcher par excellence, and he lives in Chennai, very Trichy, which is a beautiful place. And also he's a surgeon for the eye. And the eye surgeon is a medical doctor. And not only he can correct your eyesight, but also deep inside the eyesight, how you interpret things inside through history. So without delay, let us welcome Dr. M.L. Raja from Trichy, India.
Namaskar.
So Dr. Raja, when you talk about India, and India is a Greek and Latin word from Hindu, but Bharat, if you talk about Bharat, which is another name for India, those who do not know. It is a more respected name also because it's in Sanskrit. So when you talk about Bharat, the entire Bharat is full of evidences of Mahabharat. Isn't that right?
Yes.
So what do you have to say on that a little bit before you start?
See, even for Ramayana and Mahabharata, Tamil Nadu is a down south place. When you compare to the incidents that happened in North India, that is Rama from Ayodhya and Krishna from Dwaraka and Kurukshetra, Hastinapura, everything is North, or Dwaraka, Middle North. But Tamil Nadu is down south, at least 1,000 kilometers away from the main incidents. Land, that is Northern Bharat. But even if you say in Tamil Nadu, there are lot of evidence for Mahabharata. See, in Mahabharata, I'll quote how it is, even Tamil Nadu, you can take an example, that is a far away place from the main land of Mahabharata, thousands of kilometers. See, in Tamil Nadu, there is a largest Chinnamanoor copper plate. In that, the Pandya king, who is a grandson of Jadila Parantaka Pandya, that is Varakuna Pandya, he mentioned that he helped Arjuna to relieve his curse from Vasu. It's an important thing. And this Pandya king, with his elephant force, defeated the chariots of Duryodhana. So that it is mentioned there in larger Chinnamanoor copper plate. And in many places of Sangam literature, you can see evidence of Mahabharata. For example, I will quote one thing. The Pandya king and Chola king, they are sitting nearby and chit-chatting. And when a Tamil poet sees this, how he compares. Pal niravuruvin panaikudiyonum, neel niravuruvin neemiyonum. Pal niravuruvin, but that means who is in white or fair color. Panaikudiyon, who is having that palm as his symbol, that is Balarama. Neel niravuruvin, that is who is in blue color. Shamala. Nemiyonam. Nemi means in Tamil, it's chakra. So he is having chakra in his hand and he is in blue color, that is Krishna. Balarama and Krishna, if they sit together and chit chat, it will be like this. You like Balarama and Krishna, you chit chat together. Why he has to compare the persons who are in north? So that much was the influence, that much the people identify themselves with Balarama, Krishna and Mahabharata incidents in Tamil Nadu. That you have to understand. Even in Mahabharata text of Vyasa, he mentioned that Sakadeva, he came to Pandya Desha. At the time, the Pandya king was not in Madurai. At the time, there was some flood. His lower country was submerged in sea. So he moved north to the Vaigai River and he constructed constructing the Madurai fort. Before that, he is staying in a place called Manalo. Arjuna came there and married Sitrangi, the Pandya king's only daughter. So, through that daughter, a son was born and he became Pandya king. So, the Pandya Vamsa is halfway Pandava Vamsa. So, that much is the relationship. There are many temples in Tamil Nadu which is connected with Ramayana and Mahabharata. That if you read Sthala Purana, even Ramanathapuram and Tiruchi, Tanjavur, many temples, either Vishnu temple or Shiva temple, there are many places. If the Sthala Purana you read, it directly connects with the incidents of Mahabharata. That much is the inseparable thing of Mahabharata in the life of your day-to-day life of persons throughout Bharat. I am quoting only an example, Tamil Nadu. Why I quoted? Because it is the far away place. That place, that much was connected. Then what do you say about the Uttar Pradesh or Gujarat with Mahabharata? That is the thing we have to understand.
If we look at the history of our acharyas, acharya means the teachers. Most of the teachers in Vrindavan or in Varanasi are from South India, from Tamil, Karnataka and Andhra. Most of the teachers are from there. Acharyas, we call it, the topmost teachers. They are coming from South.
Shankara, Ramanuja, Matva. All three from South only.
Yeah, all the major...
Gods are from Rama and Krishna from North. But Acharya from South. So we respect both. Yeah, even Northern Bharat people respect these three. We Southern people, we respect Rama and Krishna. So it is one nation, one culture.
So most of the North-South divide has come from Christian missionaries from Europe.
Yes.
Because they did not translate or they did not know Sanskrit. And also they had some ulterior motives. And therefore they tried to create a division. Dravida versus North Indian, Arya. You know, the definition of Arya means that very simple, one who is educated and well-versed.
Who is cultured.
Cultured, who is very well-cultured and educated on the Vedic background, Vedic culture.
Yes.
So that's called an Arya. So the definition of Arya means a very civilized person, very cultured man. And Arya is also. Sometimes they say to divide people further, they will say that the North Indians are come from Europe, which we all have debunked conclusively, because it was the Indians who went to Europe and civilized them, not they were civilizing us. So when we talk about the whole India, and we see a complete integration, not just India, Southeast Asia, Indonesia, Cambodia, Thailand, and we talk about Bharat as a very large country stretching east as well as west to Afghanistan or further west to Madhya Pradesh also. Now, when we talk about that type of integration and all this colonial talks started from Max Müller onwards and Macaulay onwards, do you think that Indians still not understand the colonial conspiracy?
Now the situation is slowly changing. Even in Tamil Nadu, Tamil Nadu is the Dravida movement is at the highest place. With that, even political thing also changed. But even in Tamil Nadu, people are understanding that Arya is not a racial name, and also Dravida is not racial name. Dravida is a geographical name. See, Bharata is divided into Pancha Gauda and Pancha Dravida, and the southernmost part is known as Dravida, that is Kerala and Tamil Nadu. That is only a geographical name. So people are slowly understanding this. This understanding is more in the northern Bharat. They came to understand properly, and they came to understand the interior motive of British people to divide and rule, and also to convert. So that is why Thomas Babington Macaulay asked Frederick Max Müller to translate Rig Veda in a way that the Hindus should lose their faith on Veda. That and all their conspiracy, but it didn't work out. But it's worked out for somewhat in 1940s or 50s or 60s, but slowly that thing is fading away, and people are now realizing that. So that is the thing. In another 10 years, it will totally removed from the hearts of the minds of the Bharatian people. That is my confidence.
So thank you so much. I think you can share your presentation if you want. While you're sharing the presentation, I'll just repeat for the audience that Dr. Raja said that it's a geographical construct, Dravida and this is a geographical construct. It has nothing to do with the reality on the ground. So some people did not understand, but that's a different matter altogether. So yeah, please go ahead, Dr. Raja.
Namaskar to all. I wholeheartedly express my heartfelt thanks to Aditya ji, the volunteers of Sathology, and also the eminent professors, faculties, and students of various universities of America, that is USA, who are listening my lecture. Namaskar to all once again. In this session, I am going to narrate the Assam to Kurukshetra via inscription. That was the title. That is how we derive the Mahabharata date, that is the Kurukshetra war, through inscriptions that were present in Assam. So how Assam inscriptions prove the Kurukshetra war date, Mahabharata date. That is my topic today. First of all, I will consider the famous inscription, that is Nidanpur copper plate inscriptions. Many scholars knew it. It was obtained from Nidanpur village in Silhet. Silhet was previously ruled by Gaur dynasty. Now that district was in Bangladesh. And the person, the king who issued this Nidanpur copper plate inscription is King Bhaskara Varma. He is the king of Kamarupa, that is entire Assam. Kamarupa and Prajodisha are the other names in the ancient names for Assam. Assam, not only Assam, adjacent areas. And in that, he mentioned his genealogy. His ancient ancestor was Naraka. We know Narakasura. Narakasura is the son of Narayana and Bhudevi. That is to recover the earth. Narayana took the avatar as boar, and he recovered Bhuma Devi, earth from some ocean in some Milky Way galaxy or somewhere else where it was hidden. And at the time, Naraka born, though he is a son of Narayana himself, because of contact with Asura, he became an Asura. So that Naraka, later he was killed by Satyabhama because he got a boon that only his mother can kill him. So Satyabhama, who is the wife of Sri Krishna, was the avatar of Bhudevi, that is Mother Earth. So she got the ability to kill Naraka, and that happened. And after that, because of the request of Naraka to Sri Krishna, we are celebrating Deepavali. That is the thing. On the day when Naraka was killed. And his son was Bhagadatta. Bhagadatta fought with Vijaya. Vijaya means, Arjuna. of Mahabharata, who is the one of the Pancha Pandava, and his son was Pushpadatta and was Vajradatta and many kings. The fight between Arjuna and Bhagadatta. Bhagadatta was the king of Prajyotisha, that is Kamarupa and Assam, and it was detailed in Mahabharata text of Veda Vyasa in Drona Parva, and the 27th Adhyaya. Whole Adhyaya was detailing this fight between Bhagadatta and Arjuna. Many places Bhagadatta was mentioned in Mahabharata text of Veda Vyasa. So this Nidanpur copper plate inscription corroborates that, and both the inscription and the text mentioned in the same way. Bhagadatta, who fought with Vijaya, that was mentioned clearly in Nidanpur copper plate inscription. So that was the tradition, how the truth, even after thousands of years, that was carried out. That we have to understand. And this inscription, what it mentions, after this Vajradatta, there are many kings who ruled in that kula, that is in that vamsha, for 3000 years, 3 sagasra varsha, that is clearly mentioned in that inscription. After that, Bhaskar Varma narrates his ancestor, that is King Pushya Varma, Samudra Varma, Bada Varma, Kalyana Varma, Ganapati, Mahendra Varma, Narayana Varma, Mahabhuti Varma, Santramukha Varma, Stita Varma, Sustita Varma, Supratistita Varma, and after that Bhaskar Varma. So there are 16 kings plus 3000 years from Mahabharata war to the period of King Bhaskar Varma. That we have to understand. So from the date of Mahabharata war until the rule of King Bhaskar Varma, there is a time interval of 3000 years plus the ruling period, that is regnal period of 16 kings. That we have to understand from this Nidanpur copper plate inscription. This is the inscription, and the photograph is available in the publication of Archaeological Survey of India, and the entire inscription with the transliteration and translation is available in that Epigraphia Indica book. So I thank Archaeological Survey of India for using this photocopy of the inscription. And another inscription of same Bhaskar Varma is found out in a Dupi, that is it, at present it is Assam, Dupi copper plate inscription of Bhaskar Varma. This is the photograph, and it is also mentioned in Epigraphia Indica volume 13, that is mentioned in Epigraphia Indica volume 12, this is in Epigraphia Indica volume 30. So I thank again ASI for using this photograph. And this is Nalanda clay plate of Bhaskar Varma. This is the thing which was found in Nalanda, the famous university in Bihar. So Assam is far away, it is far east. Bihar is almost in the center to east of Bharat. So in that also he mentioned his genealogy, that is Sri Ganapati Varma, with his wife name also mentioned, Mahendra Varma, Narayana Varma, Mahabhuti Varma, Santramukha Varma, Stita Varma, Sustita Varma, Supratistita Varma, and Eskala Bhaskar Varmeti, Bhaskar Varma. So his genealogy is clearly mentioned in all these 3 inscriptions. And further, what we read from Karsa Charita Banabhatta. Banabhatta was the chief minister of Karsa. Karsa Siladitya or Karsa Varma, who is from Kannauj, he ruled Pushyabhuti dynasty. And Karsa Charita was written by Banabhatta, his chief minister. He describes the earlier part of Karsa. Who is his father, who is his brother, sister, and how he came to power, like that. During that, in the chapter 7, he mentioned that Kamsa Vega is a messenger came from Assam, Kamarupa. And who is Kamsa Vega? He mentioned Prajyodhisheswarena Kumarena Prakito Kamsa Vega Nama. That is, the king of Ishwara means king, Prajyodhisha, that is Assam, Kumarena. The other name of Bhaskara Varma is Kumara. So, Kumara Prakito Kamsa Vega, whose messenger, Bhaskar Varma's messenger name is Kamsa Vega, and he met Arsa Shiladitya in Kannauj, in his capital. And in that, who are you? From where you came? Like that, Harsha asked. For that, he explained, I am the ambassador of this Kumara, that is Bhaskar Varma. And he detailed about Bhaskar Varma, his genealogy. In that also, he mentioned in the same way. See, Nidanpur copper plate, what it mentioned, the same thing, Arsa Charita, Banabatta. Banabatta wrote it. Varaha, Bhagavatiya, Bhuva, Naraka. Bhuva means earth. Bhagavata means Sri Krishna or Narayana. Varaka, Varaka avatara, Naraka. Bhagadatta, Buspadatta, Vajradatta. After that, Bhuti Varma, Chantramukha Varma, Sthita Varma, Susthita Varma, Mirganga. Mirganga is another name. Bhaskar Varma. So he mentioned there in the same genealogy. So what is, how the Mahabharata texts of Veda Vyasa, Nidanpur copper plate inscription, and Banapatta texts, Arsa Charita, everything in the mentioned in the same way. So you can buy this book from Munshi Modilal Banarsidas. P.V. Kane translated, and also English author E.V. Kovel translated. You can verify this. So Hamsa Vega met Arsa Chiraditya, and Hamsa Vega was the messenger of Bhaskar Varma. So from this we can understand that Bhaskar Varma of Nidanpur copper plate inscription, which mentions the time interval from Mahabharata to him, is 3000 years plus 16 kings ruling period, was contemporary to Harsha Shiladitya. That we can understand from this. There is another evidence, foreign evidence also. The Life of Quan Swang, written by Saman Hui Lee, and it was rendered English by Samuel Bell. Munisiram Manohar Lal published, and first publication is in the year of 1911. In that, Quan Swang himself mentioned, Quan Swang was a Chinese traveler, a Buddhist traveler who came to Bharat between the year 632-645 Common Era. And he mentioned Harsha Shiladitya and Kumara Raja, that is Bhaskar Varma, of Eastern India. He mentioned clearly Eastern India. Assam is in eastern part of Bharat. So, were contemporary. In another book, Buddhist Records of Western World, because it was written by Huan Swan's disciple under the instruction of Huan Swan, under the guidance of Huan Swan, C. Yuki. This also mentioned the same thing, that Bhaskar Varma and Kumara were contemporary. Bhaskar Varma, alias Kumara, is contemporary to Harsha Shiladitya. Not only these two books mentioned, it mentions other thing also. This Harsha Shiladitya was contemporary to Pulikeshi II of Western Chalukya Badami, which I explained in the previous lecture. So these things you understand. Bhaskar Varma of Assam, Harsha Shiladitya of Northern Bharat, and Pulikeshi II of Western Chalukya Badami, and Mahendra Varma and Narasimha Varma of Tamil Nadu down south were contemporary. That we have to understand. So what is the period of Huan Swang? How he can verify? This I explained in the previous episode also. That is, Huan Swang was the descendant of Chang Kong. He came from the lineage of Chang Kong, that person, who was the ruler of Tai Qiu during the rule of Han Dynasty. What was the period of Han Dynasty? 206 BC to 220 Common Era. So definitely Huan Swang period must be after 220 Common Era. And his great grandfather, Qin, lived during the rule of after Wei Dynasty. And his grandfather was appointed as a president of Imperial College, that is Old University of Peking, during the rule of Qi, that is Northern or later or Go Q dynasty. This period is 550 to 577 Common Era. Then Huan Swang period must be after 577 Common Era. His father lived during the rule of Xu dynasty. The period of Xu dynasty is 581 to 618 Common Era. So definitely this absolutely verify the Quan Swang's India visit, that is Bharat visit, between 680 to 645 common era, 630 to 645 common era, is absolutely correct as per Chinese records and chronology. That we came to understand. Now, again coming to Aihole inscription of Megudi temple, some people are raising some doubt in it. Last episode I explained that is the it mentions Mahabharata war as Bharatat Ahavat Idaha. Idaha means from that. Bharatat is the fifth vibhakti of Bharata. Ahava is the war. Ahavat is the fifth vibhakti. That is from which time or from which place. For that we are using fifth vibhakti. So from the time of Mahabharata war. So somebody is telling this Bharata doesn't mean Mahabharata war. They are claiming some doubts. Why? Because the inscriber is Ravi Kirti, who is a Jain. He would have not mentioned a Hindu war. See, that means they didn't understand the tolerance and acceptance of other faith of this great nation Bharat. So in Bharat, in India, if you mean Bharata, it means definitely Mahabharata war only. If you say Abraham Lincoln or George Washington in America, definitely it means Abraham Lincoln and George Washington, the past presidents of USA. It didn't mean Abraham Lincoln, who is living in New York, who is doing tailoring work or doing some other job. So Abraham Lincoln means Abraham Lincoln only. Karl Marx means Karl Marx. Lenin in Russia means Lenin only. Mao Zedong in China means Mao Zedong. Sri Krishna and Sri Rama in India means Sri Krishna and Sri Rama only. In the same way, Bharata means Mahabharata war. Even in the remotest area in Tamil Nadu, if you ask people, what is Bharata? It is Mahabharata war. I already explained the larger Chinnamanoor plates of Varakunda Pandya. He is the grandson of Jadila Parandaka Pandya. So the period of that inscription is 1100 years before that, before present. In that inscription, what it mentions? Bharatam Tamil Paduttum. That means during the rule of ancient king of Pandya, he translated Bharata into Tamil. What means Bharata? We know Vildi Bharatam. Vildi Bharatam is a translation of Mahabharata in Tamil. So even in Tamil Nadu, Bharata means only Mahabharata. Besides, how their argument is wrong, Ravi Kirti is a Jain, that may be there. But definitely Chalukya, Pulikeshi II was not Jain. Because his Lokhanar inscription mentions he is a Parama Bhagavata. That means he is a Vishnu worshipper. And in that, the 90% of the inscription describes the Chalukya Vamsa, who are worshipping Sapta Matrika, that is Sapta Kannika. And they are the worshipper of Saiva and Vishnu, Shiva and Vishnu. And further, it mentions Lakshmi, Indra, Varuna, and Nahusha. And also he mentioned the Chalukya king's donation to Brahmins. Further, it mentions Kalidasa, who is a worshipper of Sakti, Parvati Mata. And he it mentions Bharavi. Ravi Kirti compares with Kalidasa and Bharavi. Bharavi is a Shiva worshipper. Kirta Arjuniriyam. But that was the text written by Bharavi, the poet, famous poet. So he is a Shiva worshipper. So in that he mentions 7-8 names of Hindu. And he donated 90% of the inscription to describe the Chalukya Vamsavali, who are not Jain, they are the worships of Shiva and Vishnu and Sapta Kannika. So that argument is totally wrong and baseless. And if they argue like that, they don't know the basic fabric of this nation, that is acceptance of all faith. Even Rajaraja Chola, he is constructed Shiva temple. He is a strong Shiva worshipper. He constructed Buddha worshipping place in Nagapattanam. That was the tendency and tradition of this land. That we got to understand. So this Kali Yuga, it mentions Kali Yuga 3735 and Saga Varsha 556 of Mahabharata, that I have explained. In that he mentioned that Harsha was defeated by Pulikeshi II. Godwal plates and copper plate inscription of Vinayaditya, Narvan copper plate, Kendur copper plate of Kirti Varma, Vakaleri copper plate of Kirti Varma, Pautam copper plate of Vikramaditya 5, which I have shown last episode. All these clearly mentions as Harsha Siladitya or Harsha Vardhana of Pushyabhuti dynasty was contemporary to Pulikeshi, and we know the period of Pulikeshi. So from this, we can fix the period of Bhaskara Varma. Hamsavega met Harshavardhana at the earlier part of his rule, as per Harshacharita. Because in Harshacharita deals with the earlier part of life history of Harshavardhana, and in that, it mentions that Hamsavega, the messenger from Bhaskara Varma, met Harshavardhana. So that means the regnal period of Harshavardhana is 609 to 647 common era. So Hamsavega met King Harshavardhana around 610 common era, when Bhaskara Varma was the king of Assam. So thus in the year 610 common era, there elapsed from Mahabharata war 3000 years and the regnal period of 16 kings. That we understand from all these informations, all these facts. So at the period of 610 common era, how many years from Mahabharata elapsed means it is 3000 years plus regnal period of ruling period of 16 kings. That we came to understand from all these three or four inscriptions. So the 16 kings regnal period, because it is before 1500 years, at the time, the ruling period of king is more, especially after Mahabharata war. So we can have 50 years. Then it means 800 years. Or if you reduce to 30 years, it is 480 years. So thus the Mahabharata year will be 3000 plus 800 minus 610. Because we have to convert from common era to 610 common era to BCE. So that means 3190 BCE to 2870 BCE. That was the range of Mahabharata year as per Assam inscriptions. That we understand. So my two examples. If the Mahabharata war was fought before 5500 BCE, some scholars are mentioning like that. So if we apply this to that date, what will happen? So 5500 plus 610 minus 3000 means 3110 years for 16 kings. Because 5500 BCE and in common era 610 years elapsed. So 3000 years mentioned in the Nidanpur copper plate inscription, we have to minus it. And the remaining is the period for 16 kings. So 3110 years for 16 kings regnal period. If you divide 3110 by 16 to find out the average regnal period, ruling period of each king, it will be 194 years. Is it possible? For 16 kings, each king ruled 194 years. Even the age of human being is only 100 years. Maybe 120 years in the ancient period. How can they rule for 194 years? So if that date is highly impractical and unacceptable, that we can understand. Then some scholars proposing dates after 2400 BCE, that is even 1900, 1600 BCE, they are mentioning. If you apply this calculation to that, you can understand that is 2400 BCE plus 610 in common era. That means 3010 years minus 3000 years because the various kings ruling period. So the remaining will be 10 years for 16 kings ruling period. Just to 10 years for 16 kings. So each king ruled less than 1 year, 8 months, 7 months, like that. Is it possible? continuously 16 kings died within 6 months of ruling. Is it possible? Less than 1 year. So that is also highly impractical and unacceptable. So any date before 5500 or less than 2400 BCE is highly impractical and unacceptable as per this Assam inscriptions. This is the Aihole inscription place. And this is the Saneswara, the capital of Harshasila Aditya. And Kanauj is a nearby place. And this is Assam, Silgat, Bangladesh. This is Nidanpur inscription. This is Dupi copper plate inscription. This is Nalanda plate of Bhaskara Varma. So these are all the thing. So it is all connected. Whole India is connected. And coming to another inscription in Assam. This is in the same area, that is Silgat district. Now it is in Bangladesh. Batara, that is a fine spot, is a mound called Itatilla in a village called Batara in Silgat district. Now present in Bangladesh. It is written in Gaudiya letters and language is Sanskrit. It was issued by the King Govinda Kesava Deva, who came in the Gaur dynasty. And we know the period of King Govinda Kesava Deva from other evidences, other inscriptions, other literature evidences, that is 990 to 1040 Common Era. What this inscription mentions is, that is 4151 years from Pandava Kula Adi Pala Abda. Abda means year, Adi means first king, Pala means king. First Adi means first, Pala is king, first king. Which king in Pandava Kula? Pandava Kula first king is Yudhishthira, who became king after Mahabharata war. He won the Mahabharata war with the help of Sri Krishna and he became the king of whole Bharat. So he is the first king of Pandava Kula, and from him up to this inscription there elapsed 4151 years. That is the inscription mentioned. This inscription belongs to King Govinda Kesava Deva of Gaur dynasty, whose regnal period is 990 to 1040 Common Era. I thank ASI for using this inscription. This is also given clearly in the Epigraphy Indica and other texts. So the regnal period of King Govinda Kesava Deva, this Gaur kingdom of Silgat started by the King Gurak in the year 630 Common Era, and it lasted up to 1303 Common Era due to the invasion of Sikandar Khan, who is the army chief of Samsuddin Shah of Bengal. So this kingdom ended in 1303 Common Era. These are all the kings before Govinda Rana Deva, that is the Govinda Krishna Deva, he is issued this inscription. His period is 990 to 1040, and his son is Ishan Deva. And after the 21st King Gaur Govinda, it went to the King Samsuddin Shah. So we know the regnal period of King Govinda Kesava Deva of Gaur dynasty, 990 Common Era to 1040 Common Era. It was 4151 years after the era of the first king of Pandava dynasty, that is Yudhishthira. So if you minus 990, it will come about the Yudhishthira era begin in 3161 BCE. It is the beginning year. If you minus the year, last year of this Govinda Kesava Deva rule, it will come to 3111 BCE. So the range of year of Mahabharata war will be 3161 to 3101 BCE as per this Batara inscription. That is the strong conclusion we derive from this Batara inscription. That is Mahabharata war year is 3161 BCE to 3111 BCE. If we apply this to the date that is beyond 5500 BCE, what will be the regnal period of Govinda Kesava Deva? We can calculate. That is 5500 minus 4151. Because we take 5500 is the year of Mahabharata war, after which Yudhishthira become the king. So from him, 4151 years elapsed up to King Govinda Kesava Deva. Then the period of Govinda Kesava Deva will be 1349 BCE. And after Govinda Kesava Deva, 263 years, the Shamsuddin Shah become king. So who Shamsuddin Shah and Sikandar, you can, Sikandar Khan, you understand. So based on that, if you say that 1349 BCE minus 263, then it will come to 1080 BCE. That means Sikandar Shah, Sikandar Khan invaded under the order of Shamsuddin Shah during 1080 BCE, that is 3100 years before present. Whether we can accept that? At the time, there is no Shamsuddin Shah, no Sikandar Khan like that. They came only after 1000 Common Era. So definitely it is wrong and unacceptable. So for dates 2400 BCE, then the regnal period of King Govinda Kesava Deva Pauda dynasty of Silgat will be 2400 BCE minus 4151 BCE. Yes, it means 1751 Common Era. That is just 269 years before present. That is the period of King Govinda Kesava. Then when Sikandar Khan invaded, 263 years after King Govinda Kesava. Then that means Sikandar Khan invaded Silgat just 6 years before present. That is 2015 Common Era. Whether it is acceptable? No, definitely not acceptable. So any date beyond 5500 BCE or less 2400 BCE is entirely definitely wrong and unacceptable. That we should understand from Bhattara inscription. So I am coming to the conclusion point. As per Nithanpur, Dupi copper plates and Nalanda plates of King Bhaskar Varma of Assam and Harsha Charita, Banabhatta, Aihole and other inscriptions and the writings of Huan Swang, what will be the range of Mahabharata year will be 3190 BCE to 2870 BCE. That was the range. As per Nidanpur, Dupi, Nalanda, Harsha Charita, Aihole and other inscriptions and the writings of Huan Swang. Based on that, we derived this date for Mahabharata. As per Bhattara inscription of King Govinda Kesava Deva, we already shown that the range is 3161 to 3111 BCE. That was the range for Mahabharata. Then I have found out 436 inscriptions, which I explained in the first lecture with Satalaji. That is a happy moment for me. And I have found out another 125 more inscriptions dated in Kali Yuga. So 561 inscriptions are there. And the internal evidence within the text of Mahabharata of Vedavyasa, mentioning 36 years of curse in the Stri Parva, and the Mahabharata war happened at the fat tag end of Dwapara Yuga. Yes, mentioned in Bhishma Parva, Adi Parva, Vana Parva, and other Parva. And based on the Purana, which mentions that Sri Krishna left the world, after that only Kali Yuga entered. So the year of Mahabharata war will be 3137 to 3145 BCE. That is the range, because we can derive Mahabharata war date just 3 or 4 decades before Kali Yuga beginning. These inscriptions clearly show that Kali Yuga began in 3101 BCE. So based on that, this range of Mahabharata war will be 3137 to 3145 BCE. That was the conclusion from these 561 inscriptions. So based on Bhaskara Varma's inscription, 3190 to 2870 BCE is the date. Based on Govinda Kesava Deva Bhattara inscription, 3161 to 3111 BCE is the reign. And based on this 561 inscription, 3145 to 3137 BCE is the range. So this is the range as per Nidanpur copper plate inscription and other inscriptions. This is the range for Bhattara inscription of Govinda Kesava Deva. This is the range for 561 years, just 8 years range. So with that, we can conclude that definitely the Mahabharata war happened between the years 3137 to 3145 BCE, not even a 50 years before or 50 years later. That will be the conclusion, strong and absolute conclusion, precise conclusion. Based on these Assam inscriptions, we derive the date of Kurukshetra. That is the strong conclusion. I thank all the faculties and great professors and other faculties of universities and Adityaji and volunteers of Sathology and all those who are listening this lecture and encouraging me. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Now, very analytical presentation on the number of dates based on inscriptions. That leaves no doubt whatsoever. And also all of them match. So thank you so much, Dr. Raja. One question comes in. The Western, and one of my latest books has come out, one, Gold, Glory and God, just before I was traveling, so it came out. The entire dates were fudged by the Western, mostly the Christian and Vatican followers, so that the natives' sense of history is lost. And once the sense of history is lost, then they can tell their own dates. Like, for example, yesterday in one of the shows, one of the prominent Indian researchers, Vedvir Arya, claimed that how is it possible that the first AD of Jesus is established? It is not established. It was put in the 6th century or 7th century. So yes. How did Thomas land up in Tamil Nadu when even Jesus was not there? So these kind of things are there. And still, you know, the problem with the Indian psyche is, and that's why I congratulate Macaulay for confusing the Hindus completely. And that he has done a fabulous job of confusing, and Indians look up to the West to verify their dates. So the same thing, if you say to an Indian, he will not accept it, but he will quote a Western author to accept it. That is the success of Christian Macaulay teachings. And also, Dr. Raja, you know, you are speaking actually English in with the mindset of Tamil or Sanskrit. The people who speak English from the mindset of British, they will still not accept it because they are still Macaulay's children. So
yes, Macaulay Putra. They are called Macaulay Putra or Putri.
So you know how to remove this disease that anything Macaulay Putra, Macaulay says is right, and anything which Indian researcher says is not right. How to change the disease, that one?
Yes, Macaulay Putra, when I say, I remember Bhujaniya Sudarshanji. He is living me in my heart. Okay. See, basically, we have to educate our people. That we have to do. So, see, when I studied in medical college in 1970s, 80s, the total mindset is not as present day. Even I am the only person apply Kungumam and Tirunir in my medical college, out of 500 people. Imagine. Now, many youngsters, they are going to temples, they are thinking that Hindu and Bharatian history is true. Many youngsters are voluntarily coming to me and started working. You give me some assignment, we will fulfill. Like that, I found hundreds of people, thousands of people voluntarily coming and want to do and to eliminate this mindset, that slavery mindset from the fellow brothers and sisters of Bharat. So the situation is slowly changing, and this Aryan invasion theory, before Jha and other people, actually it was strongly rooted in even Tamil Nadu. Now even textbooks mention, government textbooks, that there is a theory that Aryans came from outside India, and there is an another theory that Aryans are native of this place. These two versions are mentioned in the present day history textbooks of India. So slowly the mindset changed, but we have to work. Without doing our work, without doing research, I repeatedly tell, everything is there in our literature, in our texts, in our inscriptions. Only thing is, we have to do hard work. So just typing in something in WhatsApp and Facebook, that is not sufficient. We have to work. It is, our house is not in order, so we only responsible for that, and we have to do work without bothering about the result, because Sri Krishna told, you do our work, I will give benefit, I will give the phalam. So like that I am doing work. Now not only myself and many scholars, many able scholars who are better than me, they are working in that line, and slowly in another 10 years this Mekele mindset will go away, and India and Bharat will lead the world as a Vishwaguru. That is my definite confidence, and I will able to see that one day in 10 years. That must was the, my confidence.
Thank you so much. And all the Americans who are watching the show, I would like to remind them that the history of India, just like the history of Native Americans, is never told accurately. You know, if you look at the Native American population in the US, was more than 20 million people before the European settlers first came on Northeast Canada, Newfoundland. And North America as a continent, I'm saying, just the US I'm saying, not even Canada I'm counting. And today, only 2.5 million pure Native Americans are there, and 5 million total are the mixed population total together. So the mixed population is 2.5, and 2.5 are still pure. So America is, the history of America has also not been told to you. And the culprits are the same which they did to India, the same people. Is the Vatican Church,
you Catholic can refer to Australia also.
Sorry?
Australia and South Africa.
Yeah, I'm not even counting Australians right now, Aborigines. The
Australia, New Zealand.
Just the USA, I'm saying. And most of the Americans, you do not know that the USA, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand were the only four countries who opposed the UN Convention for Protecting the Human Rights of the Natives or Indigenous People all over the world. Because all these four countries are settlers' colonies by the British, Dutch, French, Spaniards, Italians, and Sweden also, and Germans also. Germans are known as Prussia. And Prussia is also, even Russians also. There is a general Fort Rost in California. So even these are the people who colonized this land, USA. So in India also, the same people changed the history of India, same people. And you can check it out, all the facts in my latest book, Gold, Glory and God. In that I've mentioned all these numbers in detail. And so we are living in a world where the past wounds are not healed. The same colonial propaganda is still going on in different names, United Nations, UN Human Rights Commission, because these are the same powers who are controlling these international organizations. So India has always stood for the human rights of natives all over the world, beginning from Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi spoke about the rights of blacks in South Africa, the Native Africans. And also there are many other scholars of India who have commented on the American history, and even American writers, Will Durant, Mark Twain, and Theodore, I forgot the name, one more guy. So many American historians have commented, but their voices have been subdued. So please keep an open mind, and that's what Sathology all stands about.
You can refer William Digby book, yeah, The Prosperous British India.
Yes.
If you read that, your eyes will tear like anything. Yeah. How British ravaged this India. William Digby, The Prosperous British India.
Yeah. So the and there are a lot of historians, in fact, for the Mughal, and now we are coming to the terms that the Akbar was defeated by Maharana Pratap. It was defeated.
Yes,
it has been proved inconclusive.
There are proofs of that.
And 1,000 years of when people mock India, 1,000 years of Mughal rule, it didn't happen. 1,000 years. It was maximum 120 years, and that too marred with consistent defeats. Most of the Mughals could not move out of the fort. So the Mughal rule ended in India in 1707, officially, with the defeat of Aurangzeb. But anyway, these are the matters of history. History is extremely important so that you can build a confidence mind. And I will want like to see one day many of the people who are watching Sathology show and future shows, is that they need to start commenting on other countries' affairs, what is happening to natives all over the world. Believe me, in practices, all natives of the world are like Hindus, all of them, including European natives like Romanis and Visigoths, Germanic tribes, Franco tribes. They were all Hindus because ancient Greeks were Hindus, not Greeks. Greek was not a philosophy from alien. And as I am researching and finding out more, I can put out a lot of data, but the proof of research is yours, not mine. You have to do your own research and question. So I'll be then, and thank you, Dr. Raja, for sharing such a wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
And thank you all the viewers for watching. Do comment on the show and share. You know, everyone complains that we Sathology has very less subscribers as compared to other channels. Believe me, our content is also very special. We have long shows and we go into the depth of every research, and most of the people do not they're looking for short videos. But you know, these are the matters of importance. We have to have long videos, and you have to have patience also to learn it. So please share and do let me know your feedback. And Dr. Raja also comments on the show, so in this video, if you like to put some comment for him, he will be watching and commenting on it. Namaste and thank you.